President here, Amy Brimmo, and thank you so much for being here. Which includes the most incredible team that I've ever seen operate in City Hall, our leadership team, our mayor's office staff. Let me tell you, a year and a half ago, I looked around our city team, our public employee team, and I could see librarians sewing masks by hand. I could see rec leaders delivering over 2 million meals to families in need. I could see firefighters stopping everything to process applications for emergency financial assistance for St. Paul residents and their families and small businesses. And I would say to them, hey, thank you. I know this isn't what you signed up for. And they said, we signed up to help people. Yeah, please. It's no mistake that we are where we are today, because this place that we're at is a place that was not built yet 4 years ago. It's a place that we've seen people of all ages, people of all cultures, people of all races, people from all neighborhoods come together. It's also a place that a year and a half ago we saw one of the hardest nights in our city's history. This place represents the building that we have to do. It represents the work that we have ahead. It represents the pain and the trauma and the frustrations that we've had all wrapped up into one. This place that we're in, is an important thing to note. And I want you to think about this place that we're in. We've been through a hard last 2 years. And let me tell you, my grandfather used to say, if experience won't teach you, then nothing will. Let me tell you what I think these last 2 years have taught us. You know, Martin Luther King once said that we all live in this inescapable web of mutuality, wherein what impacts one of us directly impacts all of us indirectly. Paul Wellstone said it a little more brief. He said, we all do better when we all do better. And our governor just says, we're all part of one Minnesota together. I think what they're trying to tell us is exactly what these past two years have taught us really clearly. And that is, as long as one member of our community can't afford a stable home when it's time to shelter in place, as long as one member of our community can't go straight to the doctor when they have symptoms or take a week off to quarantine or care for a sick child, that we are all less safe. Right. We're in this together. And so let me tell you what we've tried to do, and I've learned it actually listening back to you over the course of these last couple of months in the course of this campaign. What we've tried to do over the past couple of years is reject an old model of city building that we've inherited that centers around, one, a public safety strategy that I think is borrowed from the wild, wild west. It says we're going to find all the bad guys in town and root them out of town. An economic development strategy that says we're going to look outside of our city for promise. We're going to look outside of our city for prosperity and potential, and we're going to try to bring them in. That doesn't work, because all it identifies is problems internally. And all it identifies is opportunity or potential externally. And so we're turning that on our head, and what we've tried to do with our partners on the city council, what we've tried to do with our partners on the county board, what we've tried to do with our incredible partner in Governor Waltz, our incredible partners in our federal delegation, our incredible partners all around, is just say every single day we're gonna find a new way to bet on us. We're gonna find a new way to bet on our children. We're gonna find a new way to bet on our families. We're gonna find a new way to bet on our businesses. We're gonna find a new way to bet on our city employees. So when people ask you why we raised the minimum wage, you know why we did that, right? Because we're betting on us. When people ask us, why do we create a college savings account to put $50 in the bank to start every child in on the pathway to college from birth, it's because we're betting on us. Why have we put all of these resources we have into affordable housing? It's because we're betting on us. Why did we create this guaranteed income pilot that takes families across our city and invests in them $500 a month? It's because we're betting on us. Why, when we did that? Why don't we look over their shoulder and say, make sure they're not spending on this or that? It's because we believe in the goodness of our community members, and we're betting on us.
That's right.
I'm almost done. But I want you to hear this, because I think this is important. We've had a lot of conversations, rightfully so, overdue conversations about public safety lately in our community. Those conversations stem from some awful trauma that we have endured, some heartbreaking, unthinkable trauma that we've endured together. And we've had conversations in City Hall, and we've had conversations downtown, and we've had conversations in the Capitol, and we've had conversations in kind of boardrooms across our community, and we've had far too many conversations at funerals of people we've lost too soon to gun violence. And one of the things that I've learned is that those two conversations end up being inherently different. I sat recently with a mother who lost her child to gun violence. All of a sudden, she had to bury her own child. And what she demanded to know from me isn't just how many police officers we have as a community. She wanted to know how we're investing in our young people. She wanted to know how we're going to address the tide of illegal guns into our state and into our communities. She wanted to know how we were going to make sure our young people had jobs and economic opportunity. And what I think is happening is I stand right behind my father who lost his two cousins in a double homicide in St. Paul when he was 25, is that our grandmothers and our mothers and our cousins and our aunties and our neighbors have been telling us for a really long time that we have to shift our approach to keeping our young people safe. But they haven't had the same political power. They haven't had the same microphone. They haven't had the same megaphone, platform, or voice that some of us have had in City Hall. And that's why this work isn't just about me. That's why this work isn't just about you. It's about bringing all of us to the table. And when we say we're all in this together, we really have to mean it. You can't just say we're all in it together. You have to mean it. And when we mean it, it means that if we're going to advance the interests of workers in our community, it requires us making sure that St. Paul is an incredible place to employ people and do business. If we're going to say we're all together and all mean it, it means that if we're going to advance the interests of renters in our community, it requires ensuring that our community is also a great place to rent out an apartment or build an affordable housing development. It means that if we're going to demand that the world recognize the humanity of Philando Castile, of Dante Wright, of George Floyd, that we also have to recognize the humanity of the men and women who serve our community in uniform every single day. I'm here because I believe in you. I'm here because I believe in us and what we can do when we work together. I'm here because I believe that St. Paul is big enough for there to be room for every single person at the table. And I'm excited to say that I'm gonna be here. We're gonna be here together doing this work for at least another 4 more years. Thank you for coming out here tonight.
Thank you guys all for being here tonight. Thank you. Thank you so much.